Hello, you malty maple leaf hockey teams. A bit of a Canadian style malt mention there, and thank you to 86 Beeman for that malt mention. Introducing Whisky Review 444. Now, I won't be a minute, bear with me, I'm looking out a malt mark. Wonderful. Scotch single malt whisky. This is Springbank 12-year-old cask strength, and I'm reviewing it now for a reason. Apart from the fact that it is absolutely delicious, I've been thoroughly enjoying it, and I would have absolutely no qualms whatsoever about recommending you to buy it. I did. In my last review, 443, I reviewed a rather delicious independent bottling of Mortlach. For the simple reason, in my opinion, it represented far better value for money than the official bottlings, which have been brought out in this year, 2014, springtime, roughly about April, May. And it's something that has been concerning me about some of the releases of single malt Scotch whiskies, in which the reputation of them is being, to a certain extent, exploited. Now, that's a customer's perspective, but we mustn't moan about it, because the primary role of any commercial business is not their product or their service, it's about making profits. So it is in the interests of a producer of whiskey to seek the most cost-effective way of creating profit, which it justifies the viability of the business and the activity of manufacture. It is not rocket science, it's pretty simple, and it's something that Springbank do really well with the minimum of advertising, because they have a particularly long-term successful reputation as regards the intrinsic quality of what they produce. They don't produce much whiskey because they don't have big stills. Everything that is involved in the production of single malt whiskey, they do on site at the distillery, from steeping and malting the barley to grinding it, resting it, then grinding it, then mashing it, putting it into the wort. I'm getting myself totally mixed up here. How do you make whiskey again? Gotcha. They put it into the mash tuns, where they extract the sugars from the malted barley, and then the wort that is created, the sugary solution, is put into washbacks, where it is then fermented with the addition of yeast, after which it is put through three stills, yes, because Springbank, like Mortlach, which was my previous review, is 2.5 times distilled. So it goes through the wash still, then it goes through the spirit still, and then a proportion of what's been through the spirit still goes into a third still. And this gives you a simply different product. And the reason these two distilleries 2.5 times distill their single malt is purely by default. Some point in production, they found that it worked quite well, so they've continued it as part of their tradition. Lovely stuff. Once they have distilled the liquor at Springbank, they mature in traditional casks, in traditional dunnage warehouses, mainly, and you get what's called a traditional result, which just happens to be time-tested and to multi-maniac-y, nerdy, anoraki types like myself. It's just fantastic. And that is why I have no hesitation in saying that, in my opinion, Springbank is Scotland's finest distillery, bar none. If you are a whisky distillery anywhere in the world and you want to copy a Scotch whisky distillery, Springbank is the one you copy. It's the one. They're not really big in marketing. They certainly have a lovely lady who deals with the marketing and promotional sides. And they're very successful at this. They do things the old-fashioned way by travelling around and having tastings and making donations to local groups who are raising funds for different good causes. All works. Oh. And they don't overcharge. They don't produce outrageous presentation and expensive marketing campaigns with people who wander about with cell phones in each pocket, networking and being super busy, and perhaps occasionally clueless as to how distillation actually works. Yeah, it can happen, you know. The nose on this is just fantastic. This is bottled at 46%. It is unchill filtered, and it's a natural colour. That is not just something that Springbank occasionally do. They commit to that in every single one of the single malts that they bottle, that it is a minimum 46%. Syrupy, buttery, complex malt and grassy notes. Dates, sweet, fresh fruit, strawberries, red currant, sultanas and vanilla, forest honey, and a little bit of cookie dough. In relation to the quality of the single malt experience that you get for the money that you pay for a bottle of 12-year-old cask strength single malt whiskey, you simply don't get much better. Once you have practice on a few standard, easy drinking single malts, which are ready to go at 40%, you need a challenge, you need points of reference, and this is a very good place to start. Sweet, slightly sour, slightly salt. Right from the arrival, complex, considerable maturity for 12 years old, you really get an immediate sensation that all the casks used in this batch are good casks. They're not just putting in some dead cask filler to pad it out. It's not their style. In other words, this is a distillery that spends the money where it's most important, in production and in casks. They also employ proportionally a lot more people in their operation than many other distilleries, as a result of which they are an invaluable asset to the local community. I approve of that. To me, that is very effective marketing. That's marketing with pixie dust over it. Nutmeg. Sorbet. Caramel sorbet. Lemon juice. Lime rind. Coriander. Basil. Thyme. Just a tiny, tiny hint of coconut. I wouldn't expect that coconut note at a Springbank at a younger age. It's much more prominent in Springbanks over 20 years old. But I do know that when they are preparing a batch for bottling, if they feel like putting some older stuff in, they'll do it. Finish. Floral tea. Jasmine tea. A dense, complex honey note. Mocha wood. Wood mocha spice. And a sort of fruit, slightly sage, savoury herbal note. From start to finish, substantial, complex, traditional single malt. And I'm going to give this 92 out of 100. And it's a malt mark. I have tasted single malts twice this age, which have not carried as much complexity and maturation. Anything else I'd like to add, apart from being a bit of a Springbank fan? In terms of collectability, you can't go wrong with a Springbank. All Springbanks are collectible whisky because production volume is limited and restricted. There are some Springbanks which are iconically collectible, some organic, old 1960s Springbanks really spring to mind because purely on intrinsic merit, that's what made them collectible. No marketing departments, no flannel and fizz, just pure quality. And recently I reviewed Springbank Rundlets and Kilderkins. And in my opinion, malt mates, that is a modern collectible Springbank because it's such substantial quality. If you can't find a Rundlets and Kilderkins, you can certainly find one of these. It comes out batch after batch after batch. And it's worth noting that they're finished whiskies, whether it be Tokai, which is can be very dodgy cask for finishing a whisky, whether it be Madeira, whether it be Burgundy or Claret or whatever. Springbank are very good at getting double maturation right. In other words, they make sure that the engagement, the length of time of engagement, is sufficient to be effective. There are other double matured whiskies, distiller's edition whiskies, extra matured whatever whiskies, which do not have that same result. I hope you've enjoyed this whisky review. I'll be back again shortly with whisky review 445, where I will be reviewing another whisky from Springbank, which is not called Springbank, but no more spoilers. You'll have to come back and watch to find out. I'm Ralphie in the Manx Bothy, and I'll see you soon.